Hi class, it's Bill Berry with an introduction to Chapter 4, Repetition Structures. There's a lot of good stuff in this chapter, very important stuff, another basic building block of programming that we need to master. And so we're going to do some examples together so you can actually see them typed in and working and develop the thinking behind them. And it should be a good chapter with lots of good stuff to learn. First of all, quick agenda. We're going to look at the different types of repetition structures that exist and what Python offers to you. We'll talk about how to use these to create running totals. Talk about sentinel values and how those can signal us that input or some sort of processing is finished. And we're going to look at some applications specifically of loops. Another one is an input validation loop, so you can make users do what you need them to do. And last but not least, we'll talk about nested loops. That's loops within other loops, so very good stuff. First of all, there are two kinds of repetition structures that are offered in Python. The first one is called a while loop, and a while loop is a great thing to use when you have a condition that needs to be met in order for the loop to stop. Notice that this is condition-based, not count-based, so this will continue running until whatever condition is met. So if you don't know how many times you need to run through the loop, then this is the way to go with this. One thing that's easy to do with this, that's easy to create a loop that either never runs or never stops running, so you can create infinite loops. And one of the key things that you need to do when you use a while loop is make sure that somewhere within the while loop you are making progress toward finishing the loop. In other words, whatever the condition is in the loop, you need to make sure that progress is made toward getting that to be, you know, done. So that's something we'll watch as we create these examples. The other little detail here is the condition is at the top of the loop, so some programming languages offer you two different kinds of loops, one with the test at the top and one with the test at the bottom. We only have one kind here, so sometimes that takes a little bit of thinking to figure out exactly how to make it run and not go over one and things like that, but again, we'll watch that as we're creating. Now, another type of loop that is very useful here and is provided in Python is called a for loop, and for loops are used in cases where you either have a count where you need to run the loop a certain number of times. So if you know, for instance, that you need to process 10 things or you need to count 10 numbers, a for loop does that for you very nicely. But in Python, it's extremely powerful in an additional way, and that is that it also can be very useful in collection-based processing. So anything that is a sequence or a collection, and I'm using these terms very generically at this point, but anytime you have a set of things that you need to process, very likely Python supports using the for kind of loop to process all of those. The nice thing about the for loop is you don't actually have to worry about the condition in the least. It automatically sets it up. Once you set up the top of the for loop, you don't have to worry about making sure that the loop is going to finish. It will automatically move forward item by item, and it will get done when it gets done. So it's a very convenient thing. You should use for loops when you can, when they make sense. Now we're going to do some examples together so that you can see this stuff in action. The first one that I want to do is an example where we're generating Fibonacci numbers. Now, I don't know if you've run into these in math, but Fibonacci numbers are, you know, they start with 1 and 1, and then each next number you derive by adding the two previous numbers together. So 1 plus 1 is 2, so the next number is 2, 1 plus 2 is 3, 2 plus 3 is 5, 5 plus 3 is 8, etc. So we want to have a program that will run until we reach n, right, until we get to a certain number that the user specifies. So that's one example. Second one is display a line, a banner line of so many asterisks. Now we already know some clever ways to do that, but let's use a loop so that we get some practice there. And last line, last example, is we want to reverse the characters in a string. So if you start with hello, you want to end up with the reverse string. So you want to go O-L-L-E-H. So these will help us to sort of get the basics of repetition structures. So let's jump in and do those examples. So first of all, let's do the Fibonacci. Again, just so that we're clear, Fibonacci numbers would go in this sequence, 5, 8, 13, right? So hopefully those make sense. So let's do these things in a function just because we know how to do those now. And we're going to pass in what we want the limit to be, right? We want to let the user specify things, and then later we can have a main program that calls Fibonacci of, you know, 100 or something like that to show all the Fibonacci numbers up to but not including 100, or not going over 100. Okay, so how do we need to do that? Well, first of all, we're going to have two numbers that we're dealing with, so I guess we'll just set them up as number 1 and then number 2, right? We're going to always have these two numbers, and they start with 1s. So this is my first thinking, was that I want to print them. Let's see, I want to print num1, and I want to print num2. Now we'll refine this and make this prettier later, but let's say we start this way and we print those two numbers. Now, what kind of a loop do we need here? Do we know exactly how many numbers we need? Well, not really. The loop needs to run until we reach 100, but we don't know exactly how many that means. So that's a clue that we need a while loop. So I'm going to start with while. Notice the keyword shows up in orange. Now, how do we know when we're done? Well, when the second number, when you know we're constantly creating new numbers, when the second number is has reached its limit, then we know we're done. So we might want to say something like this: while num2 is less than or equal to the limit that's passed in. Right? So that's a good start. Now, we're making some mistakes along the way, but I want to show you the fact that program development is iterative. Sometimes you have to go over it a couple times to get it just right. So we'll make some mistakes and we'll come back and fix them. All right, so now how do we do this? How does this all work? Well, we need to have a temporary number, right, which is going to be made up of the first two numbers added together. So num1 plus num2, great. Now, we need to then swap those kind of into place here because we need them to progress. So we're going to need to start with taking what used to be in num1 and assigning, now it's going to take what's in number 2. And similarly, what's in number 2 needs to now be whatever the new number was. Notice if you pause and watch this carefully, we've discarded the old contents of num1 because we don't need it anymore, right? It's not necessary. So we discard that, shove what was in number 2 into that, and then the new added number that we created, we're shoving that into num2. And then, probably in the loop, we want to print the thing, right? So we want to print num2. All right, and that seems like it might be about right. So let's now, that's the end of our function definition, that's the end of our loop. So now we're going to save this, we're going to run it, and we're going to see what happens. So let's press F5, and let me bring this up into here, and you can see. Okay, so we have some problems here. First of all, the numbers are not displayed very nicely, but also notice that we ran over. We got 144, so that's not quite what we want, so we need to fix that. So how do we fix the first problem where the numbers are not printed on the same line? Well, we need a little trick, and that is that the print command takes an additional parameter where instead of doing a new line at the end of the print command, we want to actually say what we want the ending to be. Instead of a new line character, I want a space character. And every time I go to print, I want the same thing, right? So I want a space in both of those instead of a new line. And then at the end, of course, we're going to want to print one new line to make the whole thing, you know, finish. So now let's see if we're doing better in terms of the output. Okay, well, the output looks a lot better, but we're still running over, right? We have the 144 where we don't want it. Well, this partly is a problem because, as I mentioned before, a while loop tests at the top. Right? So here we're setting up the condition, which says we are looking to make sure it's within the limit. But notice that we're creating the new number and printing it before we ever get a chance to check it. So of course we're going to run over by 1. So the trick for that is, instead of printing at the bottom, we're going to have to find a way to print at the top. So I'm going to simply cut and paste that line at the top, okay, so that we get the printing there, and then when we create the new number, we don't print it until we loop back to the top of the loop. So if it's over 100, we're going to get out. So that solves one problem, but it creates another. Let's run, save and run that, and let's look at that. Well, this is great, but now look at the beginning, and there's 3 ones. Because when we enter the loop, we still have 1 and 1, and then we go ahead and print the first one right away. So obviously, we don't want to print number 2 outside of the loop. We want to print it the first time inside the loop. So this will print the second 1, and then we'll be off and going. So I believe we now have the right the right stuff in place. And let's then see, we might want to put some comments like swap numbers into place and then set up the initial numbers. We could put some comments and things like that, but you get the general idea. All right, so there's our program. Let's run it one more time and make sure indeed that looks like it's perfect. So we have our first looping program and we've walked through the logic to understand what's going on there. So if you want to take a look at that, pause the video, maybe try it yourself if you like, and that gives you some ideas of how to work with loops. Let's move on to the second example. So again, pause, read, copy if you need to, and then let's move on to the next example. Okay, second example, I'm going to go ahead and erase this. The second example that we talked about is we want to display a banner line of a certain number of asterisks. So how are we going to do that? Let's create a function again called display banner, and you're going to say how many stars, star count, let's say. Right? And within that, we want to print out a whole bunch of stars, however many the user says. So now we know another clever way to do this, but let's do it with a loop just so we get the practice. First of all, we always have to think about, is this going to be a while type problem or a for type problem? Is it a condition based or a count based? Well, in this case, since we know how many stars we need to print because we're going to pass that in as a parameter, we can use a for loop, which is much more convenient. So I'm going to do that. Start with a for loop. Now, what do you need to do to set up a for loop? Well, you need a loop counting variable or a loop, a loop variable to store the data as you progress through the loop. So in this case, I can do just use the number count or index or something like that. I'm going to use the word index. So actually, let's just use count. That's fine. Okay. And so I'm going to say for count in. And then you can put the name of the collection if you're processing a collection, or if you know that it's going to be a specific number, you can use the special way to function, built-in function called range, and you say how many you want to do. In this case, I'm going to do star count. Now, when you use the range function, it's going to start at 0 and it's going to count all the way up to, but not including, the number that it's specified here, because that's the stop value. So if I put a 5 in there for range, it's going to be first 0, then 1, then 2, then 3, then 4, which is 5 values, which is the right count. So that's a good way to get us started. Now, range has some other options. You can also give it a start as well as a stop. So if you don't want to start at 0 as the default, you can do that, and you can look into that separately. All right, so now for each one of these things, what do we want to do? Well, we want to print a star. Alright, but if we do that, the stars are going to go down the page and not across the page, so what do we do to make it work? Well, we want to set an end value of quote, quote, nothing inside. So instead of a new line, which would be the default, we want to do nothing at the end of the print statement. We just want to stop. So that's what that will do. And then, because that will, if we just leave this, if we leave that as the whole program, that's going to leave us at the end of the line. We probably want to hit return, a new line, and get back to the beginning. So outside the loop, I will do one more print statement just to make sure that I get a blank line at the very, very end of the stars. Now, does this work? Well, let's see. Let's do disbanner 5. Why do I start with 5? Because I can count 5 stars a lot easier than I can count 60 stars or something else. So let's run it and let's see what we got. Okay, there we go, 5 stars. Looks fine. Let's try it again. Let's try now 60 stars and let's see how that works. And there, in fact, we don't need to count them. Hopefully we've done some testing and we can make sure that they do what they need to do. So that's a quick example of using a for loop. All right, again, pause, copy, spend some time thinking if you want, and then we'll move on to the next example. That example is going to be reverse the characters in a string. So, to reverse the characters, again, I'm going to create a function. Just be in the habit of creating them because you're going to use them for so many things. So you're going to pass in a string and you want to reverse it. So if you start with hello, you get O-L-L-E-H. Now, how do we do this? Is this a count-based thing or is this a collection-based thing? Well, this is our first example of a collection or sequence-based thing. So we're going to be able to use a for loop. Again, this is extremely powerful in Python. You're going to see this used so often in Python, a for loop. So how does this work? Well, we want to process each character in a string. So I can do something like this, for ch in whatever string was passed into the function. This is going to go character by character, so the variable ch will contain one after another every single character in the string starting at the beginning in order. Now how do we, what are we going to do inside the loop here to reverse the string? Well, what I need to do first is I'm going to start with an empty string, which is going to be my reversed string. And I'm going to make it an empty string because inside this what I'm going to do is I'm going to keep tacking on characters. So each time through the loop I want to take the string. Now this would be a mistake if I do this. Remember, if I do plus with two strings I am concatenating them, but if I do this I'm not reversing the string, I'm just making the string up again from scratch, which isn't very useful. So I'm gonna go ahead and print that just so you can see, print the reverse string, and we'd want to return it, of course, in a real example. But let's do this reverse string hello. Let's make the mistake and then let's see it in action. All right? Oops, okay, so rev string is not defined. String reverse is the name of the routine, not rev string. Okay, so if I say hello, I get hello. Well, that's not very useful, so I want to make a change here. Instead of tacking on the character after what was in the previous loop version of rev string, I want to tack it on at the beginning. So as I build up, I keep adding them to the front of the string, not to the end of the string. Think about that. All right, is that going to solve our problem? Well, let's see. I think that might. Sure enough, there's our reverse string. So that is a loop version of, or rather, yeah, a loop version, but using for and using this concept of a collection or a sequence. And again, you're going to see the for in a lot of places. It is Pythonic, right? It is sort of classic Python to use for in all of these cases where you possibly can. It's really, really useful and it makes it powerful. Notice we don't have to move forward any kind of variable. We don't have to worry about infinite loops. It's really very powerful and very cool. So that covers all of these things that we wanted to talk about and these types of repetition structures and the examples. We have a lot of examples to cover, so there might be several videos, but hopefully these are useful to you as you see these programs developed and the examples done before your eyes. So we'll continue in the next video. Thanks for watching this one, though.